Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Future Humans, Inside the Science of Our Continuing Evolution, by Scott Solomon. Narrated by Donald Corren. Introduction. We humans are an odd species. I make that statement as someone who studies insects for a living, so I feel I have some perspective on strange critters. There are far more insects in the world than people, but humans are the only organisms that have come to dominate the Earth so completely. We have found ways to modify our environment to suit our needs, building climate-controlled spaces that allow us to live almost anywhere. We grow our own food, use chemicals to combat diseases, and propel ourselves in machines that allow us to move effortlessly from place to place. We have literally left a mark on our planet that is visible from space, which we know because we have been there and seen so for ourselves. Yet our species has not always been so remarkable. Our ancestors from just 6 million years ago would, if they were alive today, be recognized as just another great ape, much like the chimpanzees, gorillas, and orangutans that are still among us. In fact, living chimps can trace their lineage back to that same ancestor, but for whatever reason, the intervening 6 million years did not result in nearly as much change for their lineage as it did for ours. To get a sense of just how much has changed along the branch of our family tree that led to the twig we call Homo sapiens, I visited the David H. Koch Hall of Human Origins on the second floor of the Smithsonian's National Museum of Natural History in Washington, D.C. The exhibit focused on some of the more notable milestones in our evolutionary past: walking upright on two legs, developing tools, growing substantially larger brains, harnessing fire, and developing language. Characteristics we take for granted as quintessentially human, but that are relatively recent developments. Seeing such an exhibit also makes it clear how much we now know about our past. Over the last century and a half, archaeologists and paleoanthropologists have unearthed an incredible number of bones, tools, and other traces of our ancient ancestors. Many of these discoveries have occurred in just the last few decades. It doesn't seem like that long ago I was a college student at the University of Illinois who became fascinated with the study of human evolution. I took every class I could find on the topic and even considered pursuing it through a career in biological anthropology. Many of the fossils on display at the Smithsonian, fossils that have provided key insights into our evolutionary past, had not yet been described when I was an undergraduate in the 1990s. In 1871, Charles Darwin wrote The Descent of Man and Selection in Relation to Sex, a sequel to his book on evolution, already famous, in which he extended his theory about how species change through natural selection to argue that humans evolve too. But the fossil evidence that would later support his claims was not yet available. The only fossils of a human ancestor that were known were the remains of Neanderthals, Homo neanderthalensis, discovered in Germany in 1856, which were decidedly more human-like than ape-like. Darwin predicted that additional and far more primitive hominids would be discovered, and he even went so far as to suggest they would be found in Africa. It did not take long for part of his prediction to come true, although at first it seemed Darwin's geographic speculation was pretty far off. In 1890, only 20 years after publication of The Descent of Man, Dutch anatomist and paleontologist Eugene Dubois unearthed the fossilized remains of what is now recognized as Homo erectus on the Indonesian island of Java. Eventually, Darwin's conjecture proved to be correct. The earliest members of the human lineage, known as hominins, did indeed come from Africa. The first to be discovered on the African continent came from Zambia, and then another, even older fossil was found in South Africa. Many more discoveries would follow. A wall of fossil skull replicas in the Smithsonian display made it clear at a glance just how many have since been found. It also showed how much has changed in our lineage, even just from the neck up. Some skulls had thick eyebrow ridges and a bony crest running across the top, while others had a muzzle that looked more like the face of a chimpanzee. Some fossils had both chimp-like and human-like features. I took a close look at an artist's full-body reconstruction of Lucy, the famous fossil skeleton of Australopithecus afarensis, discovered in Ethiopia in 1974, and could clearly see that she had feet like ours, but a small head, showing that the ability to walk on 2 feet evolved before a large brain. Our own species is relatively new, though our exact age is the subject of much debate. The leading candidates for the first fossil Homo sapiens come mostly from Ethiopia, and radiometric dating of volcanic rocks near the fossils suggests that we had come into existence by about 160,000 years ago. By 50,000 years ago, the first Homo sapiens left Africa, following the trail blazed 1 million years earlier by our cousin Homo erectus. We spread far and wide, and would eventually come to occupy nearly every corner of the globe. That's usually where the story of human evolution ends. We evolved at some point in the past into modern people who eventually developed agriculture and civilization, and the rest, quite literally, is history. Looking at the skeletons on display at the museum, I could see how someone could assume that biologically we are the exact same people we were 150,000 years ago. Our bones certainly look the same, and it stands to reason that the evolutionary processes that shaped our ancestors no longer apply to us today. After all, many of us live in permanent structures with controlled climates that keep us separated from nature. We can wake up on one side of the planet and sleep that night on the opposite side. We use chemicals to sterilize our living spaces and our bodies. When we get injured or sick, we can have surgery to repair the damage or take drugs to eliminate the disease. If we have difficulty having children, we can make an embryo in a lab and have it implanted in the womb. We have created artificial limbs, hearing aids, and contact lenses. In today's world, it hardly seems true that only the fittest survive. Although there is general agreement among researchers that humans evolved from chimpanzee-like ancestors, there has never been a scientific consensus on whether human evolution is still occurring. The philosophy of eugenics was created in the late 19th century by Charles Darwin's cousin, Francis Galton, based on the misguided principle that our species is headed in the wrong evolutionary direction and that steps should thus be taken to intervene. Eugenics became a discipline unto itself, and although the term is today largely associated with racist and discriminatory practices, many leading scientists subscribed to its basic principles, which assumed that human evolution is ongoing, before the Second World War. Support for eugenics waned following the global outrage over the Nazi perversion of its principles. Yet the basic idea that human evolution is continuing was still championed by a few key thinkers. In 1959, Theodosius Dobzhansky, one of the most influential 20th century biologists, delivered a lecture at Yale University to mark the 100th anniversary of Darwin's landmark publication of On the Origin of Species. In his talk, which later became the book Mankind Evolving, Dobzhansky, while shunning eugenics, used the evidence available at the time to conclude that evolution continues to operate in humans, though he struggled to provide many examples. Not all of his colleagues agreed with his general premise of continuing evolution. In 1963, the eminent evolutionary biologist Ernst Mayr wrote, "We cannot escape the conclusion that man's evolution toward manness suddenly came to a halt." Though the topic is rarely discussed, Mayr's view has largely persisted. It was echoed in 2000 by another highly regarded evolutionary thinker, Stephen Jay Gould, who said in an interview that natural selection has almost become irrelevant in human evolution. There's been no biological change in humans in 40,000 or 50,000 years. In 2013, revered nature broadcaster David Attenborough echoed this idea when he suggested that we are the only species to have put a halt to natural selection. The trouble with this view is that evolution is constantly happening all around us. Any change in how common a trait, or the gene that codes for the trait, is from one generation to the next, counts as evolution. We can see, watch, observe, detect, expect, and test for it, and in some cases, predict its outcomes. Bacteria and fungi routinely evolve resistance to antibiotics. Viruses such as HIV evolve so quickly within their human hosts that the virus that may eventually cause death from AIDS is not the same virus that initiated the infection. The rapid evolution of viruses is what makes the development of vaccines against them so tricky. A virus is a moving target. We can witness larger organisms evolving too, but it requires some patience. The larger the organism, the longer it takes to grow and begin to reproduce. Because evolution is by definition change that happens over generations, the longer the time between generations, the more slowly changes occur. Nevertheless, in the 150-plus years since Darwin first introduced the world to natural selection, biologists have noted many examples of it in action. In 1986, biologist John Endler published a monograph entitled Natural Selection in the Wild, in which he described the methods and challenges of studying evolution in nature. Chapter 5 of the monograph summarizes the studies that, by the mid-1980s, had documented natural selection occurring in wild populations, that is, not in a lab. It contains a table listing every such study of which he was aware that met his strict set of criteria. The table spans 25 pages. The species include complex organisms from across the tree of life: plants, mollusks, crustaceans, arachnids, insects, fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. Making the leap from studying recent and ongoing evolution in other species to studying it in humans has taken some time. But in the last several decades, research in a wide range of disciplines, paleoanthropology, molecular genetics, microbiology, evolutionary psychology, medicine, demography, and evolutionary biology, to name but a few, has brought new data to bear on the question of our continuing evolution. The practitioners of these disciplines do not always talk to one another, so the emerging conclusion that our species never stopped evolving and that we are entering a new phase in our evolutionary history, one that makes the future more interesting and less predictable than ever before, has gone largely unnoticed. One biologist who has taken note of this phenomenon is Christopher Wills. In 1998, Wills published a book entitled Children of Prometheus, in which he made a strong case that human evolution has proceeded into modern times and that it may in fact be accelerating, and backed it up with a lot of data. Wills provided an update of sorts for Dobzhansky's case, citing numerous examples of natural selection operating in recent history and even in modern populations. Wills reminded us that natural selection is not the only way that evolution can happen. Other ways that genetically based traits can become more or less common over generations include the mixing of genes from one population to another through migration, as well as random fluctuations that can happen when populations grow or shrink, all of which is relevant to modern humans. Wills's evidence for continuing human evolution came primarily from data available by the late 1990s in the field of genetics. It was a discipline on the verge of a revolution that would confirm many of Wills's tentative conclusions, force a re-examination of others, and provide more than a few surprises. If human evolution is still occurring, how might the people of the future be different from people living today? Imagining the future of our species has long provided rich subject matter for science fiction writers, beginning with H.G. Wells's 1895 classic, The Time Machine, in which future humans evolve into two distinct types, Eloi and Morlocks. Wells's Eloi have diminished physical and intellectual abilities because of generations of disuse, and are tended like livestock by the ape-like subterranean Morlocks. A similar theme of disparity between coexisting but distinct types of humans underlies the X-Men comic books and films, in which so-called mutants possess superhuman abilities that are used first for their persecution, but subsequently make them heroes. The 2008 Disney-Pixar film Wall-E depicted a future not unlike Wells's original dystopia. Humans who have left Earth have become overly reliant on technology, rendering them obese, unable to walk, and fully dependent on machines. Other popular films, from the Terminator series to the Matrix trilogy, have imagined our future as a struggle against our own technology. But that is science fiction. What about actual science? When I reached the end of the Hall of Human Origins exhibit, I was delighted to find a touchscreen display with the words Future Humans that seemed like it might have some answers. I eagerly selected answers to a series of questions, but discovered it was an interactive game that presented hypothetical scenarios for the future. Imagine all the land is underwater. Will you have big webbed feet like a duck or long stilt-like legs like a flamingo? Meant to prompt visitors in thinking about how natural selection operates. I left the exhibit having learned a lot about our evolutionary past, but still wondering about our future. The last part of the museum display, with its whimsical scenarios, seemed to reflect the attitudes of the many scientists who have been reluctant to give serious consideration to our evolutionary future. I was especially struck by this reluctance on the evening of October 10, 2011, when I attended a public lecture in Houston given by the famous British evolutionary biologist Richard Dawkins. Having spent much of my adult life studying, researching, and teaching evolution, seeing Dawkins speak in person was incredibly exciting. He was promoting his latest book, written for children, about the myriad explanations that humanity has invented for how the world works. When he finished his carefully prepared remarks, Dawkins opened the floor for questions. After a series of pointed remarks by audience members that seemed intent on drawing Dawkins into a debate on religion, a young woman stepped up to the microphone in the aisle and asked a simple question. Are we still evolving? And if so, what are we evolving into? Dawkins replied that this is the single most common question he has asked, but that he refuses to answer it because to do so would require pure speculation. On the one hand, as a fellow scientist, I understood Dawkins's reluctance to speak on a subject for which he did not have empirical data. We are trained to be as objective as possible and to draw only the conclusions that are appropriate given the information available. Guesses, supposition, and so-called hand-waving interpretations of experimental results are not considered suitable activities for serious researchers. Dawkins was simply being a responsible scientist. On the other hand, I felt there must be something that we can say about the direction our species is headed. Do we really not know anything about the ways in which humans are still evolving? Has anyone looked for evidence of evolution in modern people? And if we are still evolving, is there really nothing we can say about which historical trends are likely to continue and which seem more likely to be irrelevant in the modern and future world? These questions became the basis for this book. To answer them, I have read hundreds of research articles, attended seminars, spoken with the people doing the research, including anthropologists, biologists, geneticists, medical doctors, and psychologists, and visited their offices, labs, and field sites. My approach has been to ask these experts what they believe we can say about how our species is changing through natural selection and the other forces of evolution, and in what ways we are likely to continue to change in the future. Where appropriate, I have used what we know about evolution in other species to shed light on our own situation. This book is my attempt to explain what I have learned, making clear what predictions we can make, and what we cannot, about our evolutionary future. As we will find out, we live in an exciting time. We now know more than ever about our biology and about our history, allowing us to peer into the future with greater clarity than has previously been possible. But at the same time, The changes we are undergoing, brought about by our own advances in technology, medicine, transportation, and by the growing impact we are having on the world around us, mean that we live in a time in which the future looks increasingly less like the past. We have become an odd species indeed, but our story is not yet over. Like all species, Homo sapiens continues to evolve. So there is one thing we can say with certainty. The people of tomorrow will not be the same as the people of today. 1. Genomes and Germs. June 26, 2000 was a big day for science. President Bill Clinton held a press conference in the East Room of the White House to make the announcement. He was joined via satellite by British Prime Minister Tony Blair and in person by two rival scientists, Francis Collins and J. Craig Venter, who represented two different approaches to tackling a major research objective, a detailed map of the human genome. Collins was the U.S. government's choice to head a massive publicly funded effort to decipher the entire sequence of all human genetic material. The Human Genome Project had begun in 1990 and included researchers from 20 institutions spanning six nations. It was expected to take 15 years to complete. Then, biologist and entrepreneur J. Craig Venter announced in 1998 that he intended to do the same in only 3 years by forming a private company, Celera Genomics, that would utilize a new, thus far unproven, sequencing technique. The ensuing competition has been described as the most ferocious in the history of modern science. In the end, both groups agreed to announce their results at the same time, and also to synchronize the timing of their formal research publications. The White House press conference indicated the scope of the accomplishment. In his remarks, President Clinton compared the first map of the human genome to the first map of North America created by the explorers Lewis and Clark, describing the genome draft as the most important, most wondrous map ever produced by humankind. News reports hailed it as akin to landing on the moon or splitting the atom. Most of the public attention surrounding the Human Genome Project focused on its promise to revolutionize human health. But deciphering the human genome had other potential, too. A genome is the sum total of all genetic material, the full sequence of DNA of an individual, that together constitutes a sort of biochemical instruction manual for how to build and care for a living thing, whether it's an oak tree, a butterfly, or a human. Amazingly, there is a complete genome inside nearly all of your cells. The DNA consists of long strings of nucleotide bases in parallel strands that are wound up tightly into packages called chromosomes, which direct the cell's function from their sanctuary inside the nucleus. Each individual's chromosomes come from his or her parents, half from the mother and half from the father, but not in identical form. As each sperm and egg is formed, the chromosomes inside them swap chunks, creating mosaics in which all of the original parts are still there, but in a different order. This reshuffling creates new gene combinations that ensure no child is too much like either parent, despite what your spouse may say about how you're turning into your mother or father. Because a genome of a living species is inherited, it is also a record of the history of its lineage. Think of a genome as a sort of ancient text that has been altered by each of its successive users to make it relevant for the current times and circumstances. The majority of our genes date back to the Precambrian era some 600 million years ago, when all life consisted of single-celled organisms that lived in the sea. Many of these genes remain largely unaltered, in our cells as well as those of every other species, since their function is so absolutely essential to the basic operations of life. Examples include the direct formation of the cytoskeleton that forms the structural foundation for cells and those that control cell division. In general, any change to a DNA sequence that affects the function of the gene it comprises should affect the organism one way or another. Mostly, the change will be for the worse. You simply cannot tinker with something as intricate as the instructions for life without messing something up. It will probably be something important. This is why most mutations to functional genes are thought to be harmful. Studies estimate that as many as 75% of mutations that swap one DNA base for another within genes cause some sort of reduction in survival or reproductive output. Though most of our genes predate the origin of complex life, others we picked up and tweaked along the way, like genes that allow us to breathe oxygen or perceive light. We eventually gained versions of genes that control the formation of our bodies, with a head at one end and an anus, thankfully, at the other. Much later, we acquired genes that covered us in hair, until changes to those genes took much of that hair away. More recent acquisitions include gene variations that govern complex patterns of thought and reasoning, as well as versions of genes that allow us to communicate those thoughts with one another through speech and symbols. Indeed, our bodies and our genes are a living testament to the lives of our ancestors, and so the deciphering of the human genome promised to provide new insights into our evolutionary past. We could find out how, exactly, natural selection has operated and which genes it has affected. We could look for clues about what genetic changes make us different from our primate relatives and when exactly we acquired them. We could piece together our history so much more thoroughly than would ever be possible with fossils and artifacts alone. The technology behind the sequencing of the human genome advanced quickly toward the end of the 20th century. As an undergraduate student at the University of Illinois in the mid-1990s, I worked in a research lab where, after first paying my dues by washing lab equipment, I was trained to sequence DNA. The method we used, first developed by British biochemist Fred Sanger in 1977, came to be known as Sanger's chain termination method, which earned him his second Nobel Prize. Sanger's method included copying sections of the DNA molecules and pasting them into bacteria, which conveniently make lots of copies of themselves, and thus also the copied DNA, simply by growing in a petri dish. The large amounts of DNA they produce could then be isolated, purified, and sequenced. Reading the DNA sequence was the trickiest part. I had to first make a very thin gel by positioning two rectangular sheets of glass separated at the top by a thin piece of plastic and then carefully tapping the other three sides to prevent leakage. I would then heat a gel solution in a microwave oven and pour it into the top of the rig, in much the same way you might pour jello into a mold, and then let it solidify as it cooled. Inevitably, a small air bubble would form somewhere in the gel, which I would carefully try to push toward the top. If I failed, that part of the gel could not be used. The DNA molecules that had already undergone the chain termination procedure would then be injected with a syringe-like pipette into narrow channels at the top of the gel, which was positioned upright, with the top and bottom sitting in a vat of liquid so that an electric current could pass through the entire apparatus. Because DNA is negatively charged, the fragments would be attracted to a positive charge at the base of the gel, forcing them to slowly pass through the gel. Smaller segments of DNA would travel slightly faster, so by the time I shut off the electrical switch after a few hours, the DNA fragments had arranged themselves neatly according to size. Dunk the gel in a tub containing a radioactive isotope that would stick to the DNA, and the fragments would appear as glowing bands on an X-ray film. Because each column corresponded to one of the four nucleotide bases, adenine, thymine, guanine, or cytosine, my job was then to simply determine the sequence of bases by starting at the bottom of the gel and moving toward the top, recording which column contained a visible band. This was slow, tedious work, which of course is why you train undergrads to do it. I began graduate school in 2000, the same year that the first draft of a human genome was announced. By that time, machines were available that could perform an automated version of the Sanger sequencing process I had been doing manually. As a doctoral student, I was fortunate to join a lab at the University of Texas at Austin that had such a machine. Ours was an ABI 3100, known as a capillary sequencer because of the thin tubes that looked like plastic spaghetti strands that replaced the cumbersome gels I had been pouring by hand. Each of the narrow capillary tubes contained a gel that would separate DNA fragments by size and use fluorescent dyes that could be read by a laser rather than by dangerous radioisotopes. The nucleotide sequence was recorded digitally and conveniently output to an attached computer. Members of our lab treated the 3100 like a sacred object. It lived in its own room, and its components had to be carefully cleaned before and after each use. But the extra care required was a small price to pay for the speed and efficiency with which DNA sequences could be generated on the 3100. It could run 96 samples at a time, each of which would read DNA fragments up to about 1,000 nucleotides in length in less than a day. Anytime the 3100 was running, which was most of the time, we knew that our research was progressing. Of course, even well-equipped individual university research labs like the one of which I was a member in the early 2000s were tiny compared to the major research institutes working on the Human Genome Project. At these facilities, such as the Whitehead Institute MIT Center for Genome Research or the UK's Sanger Institute, dozens of these machines were operating simultaneously. An MIT News report in July 2000 boasted that the Human Genome Project Consortium has been producing 1,000 bases per second of raw sequence 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. The DNA sequencing technology available at the start of the 21st century provided the raw material for making evolutionary insights from our genes. For the first time, there was an opportunity to look into the full length of the ancient text that is our genome and figure out how evolutionary forces like natural selection have tweaked it over millennia. What was still needed, however, were the proper statistical tools to extract the relevant information. On the second floor of a new glass and steel high-rise at the Broad Institute in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Pardee Sabeti stood up in front of a packed room to introduce three researchers who worked under her supervision. She was petite, with long, dark hair and glasses, and she was wearing hiking socks but no shoes. She spoke quickly, giving an overview of the type of research her group was doing, which included genetic analyses of infectious diseases and their role in human evolution. Apologizing to the group, which consisted of some of the most highly regarded medical and population geneticists from across the northeastern United States, Sabeti explained she was very tired. It was mid-July 2014, and an outbreak of the deadly Ebola virus in West Africa was keeping her working around the clock in an effort to help by using all of the resources she and her collaborators had in place in Sierra Leone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.